Okay. I'm gonna try. Not a chance.
Some people think your distance just some words on a page, that you're nothing more than fables handed down along the way. I've seen you part the waters when no one else could pull me from the deep. It's who you are to me. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are to me. Who you are to me. Sometimes I have my doubts, I'm sure that everybody does. And I wonder when I stumble, am I still worthy of your love?
And I know that I get stronger when I'm talking to you.
Open door when I'm empty, you fill me with hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are to me. Who you are to me. You're forever holy. You're the Lamb who is worthy. My forgiveness, my healer, the Messiah, my Redeemer. You're amazing, faithful, love's open door. When I'm empty, you fill me, hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are to me.
Higher
over it all, in your presence, Jesus, I stand in awe of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are to me. 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 Who you are to me.
Good morning. Welcome. Welcome, Waterway people. It is good to have you here. So this day is one of my faves, and but it does pose a real consequence for being outside. So if you see us like moving some pages around and music flying off, that might just happen with the weather here today with the wind. But it's not about us. It's about God this morning. We're here to worship God. We're here to praise His name. And just have a good time as well. So, I don't know if you got a Cheryl Klein is over here. She's handing out some papers about today, some pamphlets about, you know, what we're going to be singing. So if you do not have one, be sure to raise your hand and we'll get you fixed up.
Yeah, Cheryl would like a little bit of help. If you don't have a song sheet, raise your hand really high, and I need about three kids to go over and grab some bulletins from Cheryl and Dan that can come out and help them out. Is there like a Haley or a Destiny or a, okay, there I see an Ethan and a Brandon. Go over and grab some bulletins from Dan and Cheryl, and then find everybody that has a raised hand and make sure that they get one of their song sheets. How you doing?
I'm good.
You having a good day?
Yeah, man.
How are you guys feeling back here?
Good.
It's not too sunny?
Only while we're outside.
Only while you're outside. Yet. Thank you, Chuck. That's our drummer, Chuck.
That'll be the indicator here.
All right.
It's red or not.
So we're singing Blessed Be Your Name, right?
No, Build Your Kingdom.
I'm sorry, I got it all mixed up because the papers are flying around over here. Tanya's got her.
Can you stand here and hold my pages?
For a bit. Tanya's got her clothespins here. They're not working very well.
No, they're not.
Yeah, we have clothespins, these fancy little gadgets here that hold our papers down, supposedly.
So we're not supposed to be, like, falling apart, but you notice things are just sometimes a little awkward when we're outside. That can be the case up here as well as out there. So just roll with it. So we're going to sing. Why don't you stand up? Let's sing loud together. Build your kingdom here.
Set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. Seek your kingdom. We seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our lives, for you're our joy and prize. To see the captives' hearts released, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. Be seated.
keeps sinking on me. Okay. Our devotional scripture for this morning is found in Psalm 103, verses 13 to 19. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. As for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it, and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenant and remember to obey his precepts. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. These verses remind us of who we are. We are dust. We are going to fade away, but God's kingdom will last forever. It helps us to keep things in perspective, that our faith in God is what really matters. Our belief in him, because as it says here, that he has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. It's because of God's love for us that he cares for us and has compassion on us. And that we can trust him for whatever we face in our lives, knowing that his kingdom lasts forever. The thing that we cannot see with our own eyes is what's going to last forever. Amen. Amen. For our prayer requests this morning, our mission organization that we're highlighting this month is the Mennonite Disaster Service. So we'll be praying for them, as well as this week we received a note from Shana Sensenig, and she says, on behalf of my brother and our family, we want to thank you for all the prayers for him. He found out today the tumor is benign. He said he could feel the prayers and sense of peace through his journey. Shana Sensenig. Also, Todd Jones sent us a note saying, thank you so much for praying for Owen as he dealt with COVID. He is doing much better. So I just want to share those with you this morning. Let's join our hearts in prayer at this time. Father, we thank you that we can gather outside on such a beautiful morning. Lord, you have blessed us so many years with giving us a beautiful day to gather together outside. And Lord, thank you. Thank you for blessing us in this way. Lord, we rejoice with Shana's brother. Thanks for bringing him through that. Lord, we rejoice over Owen that he's doing much better. Father, thank you for healing them and for helping the tumor to be benign. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we also pray for the ongoing needs of those within our church. We pray for Carolyn and Elaine and Buzz and Sierra. Lord, we ask that you would continue to help them heal. Lord, we pray that you would continue to give them strength. Just help them to recover, Father. Lord, we pray for the ongoing health needs for Matt, for Donna, for Charles, for Norma. Lord, we ask that as these dear loved ones are struggling with different physical issues, Lord, that they would know your presence. Father, that they would know your peace as they continue to battle with different issues. Father, we also want to pray for Mennonite Disaster Service. And Father, we know that this has turned out to be a very busy month for them, as many disasters has come upon our country. And Father, we pray that you would give the leaders wisdom. Father, that you would guide them to areas that need help the most. So Father, use them. Use them in a mighty way, not only to rebuild, but also to share the love of Jesus with those that they are helping. Father, thank you for that. Father, we give you praise for having Pastor Jesse come back. God, I was really excited to see him. God, thank you for the time that you gave him to be away and to study. And Father, we pray that you would use him today. Use him today to speak to our hearts. Use him to encourage us in our faith walk with you, God. Lord, we ask that you would bless this service, that you would use the worship team to guide us in our singing of worship to you. Father, thank you for being so good. In Jesus' name, amen.
Join us now in a time of worship and song once again. Let's all stand if you're able. And we're going to start out by singing Blessed Be Your Name.
Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name. blessed be the name of the Lord. All praise to him who reigns above in majesty supreme, who gave his son for man to die, that he might man redeem. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. His name shall be the Counselor, the Mighty Prince of Peace, of all earth's kingdoms conqueror, whose reign shall never cease. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Not sure where you're at this morning in your walk with God, but no matter what kind of situation we're walking through, what you're walking through this morning, I pray that you can find your heart to bless God no matter what your circumstances might be this morning. Join us in this next song as we sing Everlasting God.
Grow weary, you're the defender.
The last song we're going to sing here this morning in our main worship set here is How Great Is Your Faithfulness, and you can turn to that one. We can praise God for what He has been faithful to in our lives. I can speak to that myself and how God has brought me through so many things in my life with health issues that I've had and other things. And so I join with me in praising God this morning in His faithfulness to us, in His faithfulness to our community and even our nation.
Who reigns over all and never changes or turns. Unfailing justice, unfading grace, whose promises remain. Yes, your promises remain. The heavens ring and the saints all sing. Great is your faithfulness. From age to age, we proclaim, great is your faithfulness. How great is your faithfulness. Everything changes, but you stay the same. Your word and kingdom endure. We lean on the promise of all that you are and trust forevermore. We will trust forevermore. The heavens ring and the saints all sing. Great is your faithfulness. From age to age we will proclaim. Great is your faithfulness. The heavens ring and the saints all sing. Great is your faithfulness. From age to age we will proclaim, great is your faithfulness. How great is your faithfulness.
From generation to generation.
Generation to generation, you've never failed us, oh God. Yesterday and today and tomorrow, till the day you return. The heavens ring and the saints all sing. Great is your faithfulness. From age to age we will proclaim. Great is your faithfulness. Oh, the heavens ring and the saints all sing. Great is your faithfulness. From age to age we will proclaim. Great is your faithfulness. How great is your faithfulness. How great is your faithfulness.
Praise you, God, for your faithfulness. You may be seated.
And so, church, churchy church. Can you hear me? All right.
There we go.
We're going to dismiss the kids to children's church in just one moment. However, before we do that, I understand that there was a fellow who was greeting people as they came in. He was forgetting who people were because they had sunglasses on, and he told him he'd get them chairs, and he forgot to do that. I just want to put you at ease. That guy's going to be fired from that post, and so worry not. But it is different when we're outside, right? I mean, you can see that already, stuff blowing around, and you can hear the wind in the microphone. That happens. I think it's worth it because it's pretty beautiful, and it's nice to be able to be out here and celebrating kind of the beauty of God's creation. It'll be really fun in about half an hour when we get to go eat some lunch, and that's going to be some extra fun. But I'm going to invite the kids to come forward who are going to go to children's church. That's kids between 4 years old and up through first grade. While those kids are coming forward, church, here is your job. Stand up, and I want you to greet somebody nearby. You don't need to hug them and slobber all over them or anything, but there are a lot of friends here today who you don't know yet. So look for somebody nearby you don't know. Ask them their name. Tell them yours. And just greet them while the kids come forward. So can you do that? Take a minute to greet your neighbors.
I know everybody.
Do you know everybody here?
Do ya?
Well, my name's Jesse. It's nice to see you. Hey, I love those sunglasses. Those are cool. Those are cool.
I know.
How's it going, buddy?
I know.
Clint, that's a great shirt.
I know
you too, Caden. How are you? How are you, Drew? Good to see you guys. Oh, you got an Eagle shirt? Nice to see you. Nice to see you. Oh, we got a couple more girls coming in the back. Good to see you guys.
No,
well, I'll start talking to you guys when they stop talking to each other. How long do you think that'll take? Do you think they're going to talk? 40 hours? You think they're going to talk for a long time? Some of them look like they're ready to talk for a long time, don't they? Look at them. Yeah, this guy over here is figuring out when he's going to get his tractor fixed. And that guy back there is saying, can I sit in your shade? There's some people in the back saying there's plenty of room here with us. There's, oh, you're Chris's dad. Yeah, there's all kinds of conversations going on here. Well, boys and girls, here is something that I was thinking about, and I wondered if you ever noticed this too. Do you know there's something happening next week that is just one of my very, very favorite things? Did you know that the Solanco Fair is going to be happening on Wednesday and Thursday and Friday? Like, it's so exciting for me. I just love it. Like, in my life, some of the most exciting things are, like, Christmas time and birthdays and the Solanco Fair. That's, like, how awesome this is. Do you know when I was a little boy, kind of like some of you guys are, I used to have to walk around the fair with my dad and my mom because I wasn't big enough yet to walk by myself. And do you know it took forever to walk around the fair? Do you know why? Have you ever noticed what happens when you walk with mom and dad at a place with lots of people? Do your dads ever stop and talk to lots and lots?
Yes.
Do they? Oh, when I was little, I used to get so impatient. I was so excited to see everything. When I was little, we could climb on the tractors and look at the ducks slide down the slide. Yeah, somebody likes the pals ducks. And it was so much fun, but Dad took so long. And he would talk to people, and I don't know what he talked about at all. Probably the weather, you know, which is just, that's so boring. I don't know, he probably talked about other things too. But have you ever had to wait for your parents?
Yes.
How many of you like to wait for your parents? Raise your hand if you just liked. You like to wait for your parents? Do you, Asher? No, that was a mistake. You like, no, Mason. Nobody likes to wait for their parents. But you know, sometimes it's a good idea, and I'm just reminding you now because I have to practice this too. Sometimes it's a good idea to remember that we just have to be patient. Because we have to remember, I had to remember that my dad wasn't trying to be mean to him or anything. There was just stuff that had to be done. And so I had to wait for him. Sometimes it's that way with God. Sometimes we get so excited about what we think ought to happen right now that we think God ought to do it right now. But sometimes God says, hold on, people. Just wait a little bit. And that's a little bit what we're going to be talking about with the big people here, because God is up to some really exciting stuff. And it's amazing what God is doing in our world. But there's some things that haven't happened yet that we're really excited about. And God's saying, hold on. And just wait. And now I want to tell you guys, thank you for waiting for me while I talked. I know you're excited for Children's Church. Are you excited? All right, well, before you go, you know what we do before you go to Children's Church, right?
What?
We pray. Put our hands together. I like to bow my head and close my eyes. It helps me to pray. Maybe that'll help you too. Dear Lord, I thank you for these boys and girls, and I pray that you will give them patience to be able to wait on you. Help them to have patience to be able to listen to mom and dad too. But Lord, I pray that you'll bless their hearts, that while they're waiting, they won't become frustrated. Instead, they would learn trust in you. Lord, I pray that they have a great time today at Children's Church, and bless them and Pastor Steve as he brings the message. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you see Pastor Steve over there?
Yeah.
Ready, set, go. Sorry, that was 100% my fault. Sorry, guys. Wanted to make sure you're still awake. Hey, do any of you remember having to wait on Dad? Bree tells me all the time, Dad, stop talking to people. Like, what am I going to do? I'm out, you know, we're out at the First Friday in Oxford, and you take 7 steps, and there's somebody else from church. What, are you going to keep going? You know what that's like. And I know sometimes I get caught up, when I greet people or say hello, sometimes I get caught up talking about just trite little things that don't matter very much. The weather is kind of the example that I use here today. Let's take a minute though, and those of you who have been around Waterway Church for a little while, I think we can praise God for some weather, because not only do we have a beautiful morning this morning, and this is beautiful, right? This is a nice day. But I don't know if you remember the last couple of things that we did outside. We had Bible school back at the end of June. How many of you volunteered at Bible school to help that happen? Do you remember the weather that we had that week? It can be miserably hot in June, or it can be terribly rainy. We had a gorgeous week. God bless us. He didn't have to, and we'd have been fine if he didn't, but God's blessings keep coming. And I don't know if you remember back on Christmas Eve, December 23rd of 2020, we had an outdoor kind of worship and carol service just back over here. Do you remember that? Do you remember the weather that night? It was December 23rd, and it was chilly, but we had a beautiful, clear evening, and we had some fire pits, and we could sing Christmas carols and get excited about celebrating the coming of Jesus Christ. That's such good stuff. And God just blessed us with great weather there. And I don't even know if you remember, but last summer, we had a couple of outdoor services. Our tailgate service that we had was actually on the other side of the building. Some of you might recall that. Stephanie shared her testimony over there about having gone through surgery and God's faithfulness there. And we had beautiful weather that day. So, the weather might be one of those things that feels like, oh, what a dull thing to talk about. However, let's remember, just as we sang, God's faithfulness is so great that he blesses us with things that we might say, well, I don't even really need that. God says, here, have a beautiful morning. And so I'm just thankful about that, and I'm excited about that, and I'm glad that we can be worshiping together outside today as we come together at this tailgate service. Now, if you were here last week, you know that I set a little bit of the stage. I'm going to be preaching from now until probably about Thanksgiving, preaching about the book of Revelation. And last week I spoke about some of the teachings of Jesus to his disciples and how he told them, look, you don't need to worry. You don't need to be stressed out about your life. You can think about things well, but you don't have to worry about it because God loves you. God is faithful and God will deliver everything that you need. We talked about that last week, and there was some homework given. And I'm going to do a little pop quiz here. Last week, we read from the beginning of Revelation. In fact, Revelation chapter 1, verses 1, 2, and 3. It says this, the revelation from Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testifies to everything he saw, that is the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Here was a key verse last week in our devotions. Revelation 1, 3. It says, blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. So just quick survey. How many of you, either in a small group or in your home or maybe on your own, either read parts of Revelation out loud or listened to it spoken by somebody else? How many of you did that? Just raise your hand if you did that. Okay, is that half of us? That might be half of us. Might be half of us. I have to admit to you, we didn't in our house. We had an insane week. There were not many times that we were all sitting down, and every time Melanie and I talked about it, something else happened, and so we're going to kind of reboot and do it again this week. Some of you were not here last week. I'm going to challenge you because we're going through Revelation 1. If we believe what the Bible says, it ought to affect our practices, right? And last week, I think everybody, when the question was asked, I think everybody said, yeah, they wanted to be blessed. How many of us followed up with this one way that we can be blessed? Probably more of us can do that. So I would encourage you, and especially as some of you have your small group meetings this week, read, if you can read all of Revelation aloud, do that. It'll be worthwhile. If you can listen to it out loud, do that. But let's take the Bible seriously when it says that blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy. That should be a motivator, and it's motivating me I'm just going to kind of put that challenge out to you. But isn't it amazing how we can read things in our Bibles and one moment say, boy, I'm right there. That sounds awesome. I want to go home and do that. Isn't it amazing how quickly that can leak away? Do you see that in your life? Maybe you hear something on Sunday morning, or you go through something in a Bible study, or you heard a great passage on some Bible preacher that popped up on your radio. And you think, wow, this is really deep. This is really touching me. This is really going to affect me. And then it just kind of fades away or gets forgotten. I know that happens to me sometimes. Does that happen to you? Well, that kind of thing can happen. That's why we keep getting together week after week. It's why we keep encouraging each other and challenging each other. That's why this church is here. I had somebody ask me this morning. They said, well, why weren't you wearing your team jersey? I said, well, I am. I'm wearing the jersey for my favorite team. It says Waterway Church right there. Yeah, like three claps. You got it. Thanks, Chuck. Yeah, Waterway Church doesn't get the same kind of cheers that the Eagles do, but we don't get the same kind of boos either. So it all works out. But you know, it's important that we keep getting together. And if you're kind of joining us for the first time, or if you're here with a friend and just checking things out, why do we do this? It's because we know that we are flawed people. We need Jesus Christ. And even those of us who are really trying to live well for Jesus, even those of us who know Jesus well and are maybe walking very closely with him, we need the encouragement and the reminders of being together and being with each other to say, keep at it, because this stuff just kind of leaks away. You know this. I'm not giving you news here, but I'm just reminding you why we're doing what we're doing, because it can get easy to be wrapped up in the fact that, hey, it's just nice out here. And it's fun to eat some chili and have hot dogs and fresh French fries. 15 years ago, when we had our very first tailgate service, we had it at Media Mennonite Church. The building is still there. The yard is still there. It's about a mile that way. We said, what can we do that would just be different? Be kind of fun. Somebody said, let's have a tailgate party. Everybody said, all right. And we realized when we got here on Sunday morning that most people have no idea what a tailgate party is. Because we said, hey, bring food along to share. And Kyle and Heidi, I can still remember you guys had a really great little spread. You had a grill, I think, on a tailgate. I mean, it was. But most of the rest of us were like, well, I brought my fruit in a bowl. You know, it's like, well, that's not a tailgate at all. What? So 15 years ago, we started out because we said, let's just get together. And let's just have fun. And we'll eat together. And we'll have our service outside. Just be something different. And here these years later, we're still doing it, and the crowd's bigger and the yard's a little bigger, and there's going to be more food, and I think the idea of what it is kind of caught up. But don't forget what we're really here doing. We're really here to encourage each other as we continue pressing on to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. All right, that's a whole lot of introduction and a whole lot of prelude. I want to talk with you a little bit, and it's going to be a little bit today. We're not going to go into a super deep study today, because frankly, it's hard to do that when we're sitting outside, when you've got other things going on, when you need to get up and take the kids out, and I know sometimes you do. Just roll with it. But I do want to look at the first couple of verses of Revelation 1 today, because this is going to kind of set us up as we think about some of the rest of our study. I want to give you sort of the overview. Last week was an introduction for the attitude that you can have. Today is kind of an introduction for some of the information that we're going to learn. This will give us an overview. We're going to read the first couple of verses and the last couple of verses today of Revelation. Okay? So if you have a Bible, or if you have, whether it's in paper or on your phone or somewhere else, go ahead and grab it. We're going to look at Revelation. It's the very last book of the Bible. And we're going to look at the first chapter and the last chapter of Revelation. So I read a bit of it already, but here it is, Revelation 1:1. And by the way, mentioned it last week, some of you may not have heard, the book is called Revelation. There's no S in it. There are several revelations that happen in the Bible, but this book is the revelation to John. And so when you refer to it, please refer to it as Revelation chapter 1. If you refer to it as Revelations chapter 1, God still loves you, and we still love you too, but we'll look at you funny and talk about you when we go home. Here's what it says in Revelation 1:1. The revelation from Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. He, that is Jesus, made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testifies to everything he saw. That is the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Here at the beginning of Revelation, we have a description of what it is. Not all the books of the Bible come out with this kind of an introduction. But it says, bluntly and frankly, the revelation from Jesus Christ. The word, if you go back and study the original Greek text, the word there for revelation is apocalypsis, which sounds a lot like the word apocalypse, right? You've heard that word around, haven't you? It's in the title of movies. People talk about it all the time. As, you know, every once in a while, it's a headline in the paper. Is the apocalypse upon us? What do you think of when you think of the word apocalypse? What do you think of? Do you have any thoughts that you can shout out loud? End times, Chuck. Anything else you think about? Chaos. Yeah. What else comes to mind when you hear that word? 2020. Fire. I haven't heard very many positive connotations yet. End times, that might be positive. Chaos, fire, 2020, those all sound like scary things, don't they? Well, the word apocalypse, if you go back, or it's based on the word apocalypsis, if you go back, it was really just a word that means to reveal, which makes sense. That's why translators translated it into the word revelation. But apocalypsis in the Greek is to reveal or to show. It's almost the idea of like pulling back the curtain. And if you remember The Wizard of Oz, the most referenced movie of all time, at least for old people, they at the end, what happens? They pull back the curtain and they see the wizard is just nothing more than an operator, right? Well, that's what apocalypsis means. It means to pull back the veil, to pull back the curtain, to see what's really going on. And so this shouldn't be scary or dreadful at all. I mean, how many of you would like to have some kind of vision of the future? Have you ever said, boy, I wish I would have known then what I know now. I would have bought that Amazon stock, you know, or I would have not bought that Yugo. There are those things that, you know, if you knew the future, you could have saved yourself or blessed yourself. So here, this is just this revelation from the very beginning. This is a revelation. This is an apocalypsis. This is a pulling back the curtain on what God says is going to happen. And this revelation is delivered to us through several characters. First of all, the Lord God gave this revelation to Jesus Christ. Jesus, it says, made this known by sending his angel then to his servant John. John was a believer in the Lord, and there's some argument about exactly which John this was, but John followed God closely. John knew Jesus and what it was to follow after him. And John's job was to write down all that he saw. Are there any writers here in the room? Anybody really enjoy writing? Not a lot. One or two or three. How many of you have ever tried to write down a good description of something that you saw? It's getting easier and easier to share this stuff now because you can take your phone out of your pocket, take a picture, and text it, right? But if you can't text those pictures, do you remember what it's like, you people who are my age and older? Do you remember the days where you had to write a letter to somebody or maybe even describe it over the phone? Like, oh, this guy, he's out here in this car. What kind of car is it? I don't know. It's like blue or yellow. There's these weird descriptions. Well, now you just take a picture. Here it is. Oh, that's Pete. But do you know what it's like to try to write down and really describe something? I mean, can you imagine the job that John would have had to do when God speaks through Jesus and speaks through an angel and shows John all of these visions? And you're going to see this over and over in Revelation. He makes no bones about it. He's like, I, John, saw this. This was showed to me. And now in what we have is 21 chapters, he wrote it all down and tried to describe it. This is why it's sometimes difficult, especially since the fact that he lived 2,000 years ago. It's sometimes difficult to understand this. Like, wait, what's he talking about? What's he describing here? I want to tell you that there are times when the book of Revelation is confusing. We're not going to figure it all out. We're not going to find some secret key and figure out the year and know exactly who's going to be representing whom. But we do know that there's information given to us. And Jesus Christ saw fit to speak to John and preserve it so that we can read it today. There's something that Jesus wants us to know. What is it? Well, we know from verse 3, the blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy. And blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. So even though there may be some things that are difficult to understand, we're blessed if we wrestle with it. We're blessed if we think about it, if we hear it, and if we speak it. So those are the first three verses. And then in verse number 4, we get the beginning of what might be considered a letter format. He says, John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia. So we have the writer, we have the audience. And he gives them a greeting. He says, grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and who is to come. That's Jesus. From the seven spirits before the throne. That's a reference to the seven churches, and reference to a number of things that are going on in heaven. We'll talk about that a little bit more as we go on. And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. So this is a letter. He says, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and has made us to be a kingdom and priest to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. John opens up and he says, look, all you churches, there's a message coming to you from heaven. Grace and peace to you. And then just in case they forget what they're there for, he says in verse 5, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood. He's talking about Jesus. He says, he's freed us. He's set us free from our sins. He's made us to be a kingdom and priest to serve his God and his Father. To him be glory. So here's the gospel all wrapped up in just a few lines. John says, this is what I'm writing about. This is who spoke to me. And now I'm going to describe these images to you. Look at verse 7. It says, look, he is coming with the clouds. And every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And all the peoples on earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. In other words, Jesus is coming back. John had a vision of it. One day we will see it with our eyes, we or our descendants. It says that every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. So even those who are against Jesus, even those who killed him, will see him coming back. And it says all the peoples on earth will mourn because of him. I'm not planning on mourning because of Jesus coming back. But it says here, all the peoples on earth will mourn because of him. Do you remember at the very beginning of his ministry? Jesus, in Matthew 5, is recorded as speaking what we now call the Beatitudes. Do you remember these blessings that are back in the early time of Jesus' ministry? He said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for those are the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, they'll be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are those who are persecuted. Jesus says, blessed are all these because my kingdom is coming. Now here in Revelation 1:7, it says, look, there are people who will weep. Why? Because they don't want to see Jesus coming back. You know people, and I know people in our world who have no interest in Christ returning. They want to keep their own agenda spinning. They want to keep their politics rolling. They want to keep their wars fighting. They want to keep their money coming in. You and I know people who have no interest in Jesus Christ. They will weep when they see him. This is what we're talking about here, what John is talking about here in Revelation 1. And then in Revelation 1:8, John records a quote from the Lord. The Lord says, I am the Alpha and the Omega. That is the beginning and the end. Alpha and Omega, the first and last letters of the Greek alphabet. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the A to Z. Who is and who was and who is to come, I am the Almighty. So this is the greeting of the book of Revelation. We'll unpack that even a little bit more next week. I think I got a little bit, I got my words twisted a little bit on the seven spirits and the seven churches. We'll clarify that next week too. But before we go today, I want to make sure that we do have, again, the big picture before we get into the details the next couple of weeks. So turn in your Bibles to the very last chapter of the book of Revelation, the very last chapter of the Bible. It's Revelation 21. And so John has been writing and writing and writing. To our eyes, it's 20 verses, 20 chapters, rather, of the book of Revelation. But now here he's wrapping up his letter. In Revelation 21, I'm going to start in verse 9. John says that an angel came and said to him, come here, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. Now we know from other verses in Scripture that the bride of Christ is the body of Christ, it is the church, it is us collectively together. But here in Revelation there's an image that's given, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb, and John says in Revelation 21 verse 10 that this angel carried him away in the spirit to a mountain great and high and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. This is a vision of the future, this is a pulling back of the curtain, right? This is God showing John what is coming to be in the future. And this is the picture. He showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. It shone with the glory of God. And over the next number of verses, there are descriptions about what the city is made out of and how big it is. And it's very easy for us today to kind of read it and just skip over it. But I'm going to pause a moment and just highlight a few details. I know this was talked about in our adult Sunday school class within the last couple of years. Jim, I don't remember if you were teaching it or maybe John was. But if we translate the the measurements, it's often stadia are recorded and some other things, measurements that we don't use very often. This city, this new Jerusalem that's going to come out of heaven and be down here on earth, the bride of Christ, is where we can dwell and where God will be. It was 1,400 miles on each of its four sides. A square city, 1,400 miles long. Any of you know how long 1,400 miles is? I hate to say it. I know a lot of you are wearing Philadelphia Eagles jerseys, but 1,400 miles is just about from here to Dallas. Dallas, Texas. Or if you welcome to Chester County. We'll boo, even during the sermon, we'll boo the Cowboys. If you don't like my Texas references, I apologize if I've offended you, but not really. If you don't like my Texas reference, if you would just head just about due west on Route 70. Anybody drive Route 70? It takes you out through Missouri and Kansas, just that. If you would drive Route 70 about 1,400 miles, you would just about get to Colorado. Actually, you'd end up in Bryant, Kansas. You remember Bryant, Kansas? Remember how far away that is? If we were one corner of God's city, some people know very well where Bryant, Kansas is. If we were one corner of God's city, the next corner is Bryant, Kansas, and then the two corners are 1,400 miles. This is the size of this city, the bride of Christ coming down from heaven. This is what John's talking about here in Revelation 21. It's shown with the glory of God. He goes on in Revelation 21, verse 22. He describes this city, this huge 1,400 miles by 1,400 miles. I believe that's just about 2 million square miles. That's just about half the size of the entire United States. That's how big this city is that's going to be coming down. You can imagine how John would have been impressed. He says, I didn't see a temple in the city because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. In other words, there's no church building there because God and Jesus, they're just there the whole time. You don't have to go to church. You are church all the time. This is the bride of Christ. It says in verse 23, the city doesn't need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their splendor into it. So in this new earth, in this new heavens, with this Jerusalem coming down and the bride of Christ, there's this picture of a massive city, and God is there. Nothing good comes into it. Nothing bad goes into it. Nothing bad ever happens there. It says the nations will walk by its light. It's this picture that everybody that's living on earth doesn't have to stay inside the city. You can come and go, but all the other people who, this is in the perfect future, all the other people who are following the Lord, all the other nations, they come and go into this city. They bring their splendor into it. It says in verse 25, on no day will its gates ever be shut, for there will be no night there. Always light, always safe, always glorious. It says in verse 26, the glory and honor of the nations will be brought into it. Nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. This is a pure place and a perfect place, and I just put that out there in front of you so that we can remember, as we're going through the book of Revelation, as we look at a couple other passages in Daniel and Ezekiel and Jeremiah and Isaiah, as we think about what God is doing even now and what God has said is going to happen, I want us to remember where we're going. We're going to a place, Pastor Steve reminded us this morning, we come and go, right? We're like the flowers of the field. And everything on this earth is one day going to disappear. There will be a new heavens and new earth. And this is what it looks like. A massive city where God is present, so present there's never any nighttime. There are no bandits because they're done away with. There's no sin. There's nothing false that happens there. But people can live in this city and be close to God. If they feel like going out and living in the rest of the redeemed nations, go do it. There's a whole new earth out there. This is what's being pointed at. God's kingdom is coming. And that's the revelation that John gets. Now, we have a whole bunch of chapters to unpack about some of the specifics. We might look into what's going to happen in what order. We may not know what years things are going to happen, but we know that A has to come before B and B has to come before C. That's what we're going to talk about. So I wanted to just share this with you today so you can see what kind of ride we're on and where we're headed. There's three things that really kind of hit me, three convictions that I have about this study, and I'll just share them with you so you know where I'm coming from. Number one, I find it very helpful to read Revelation 20 and 21 very often because it just reminds me where everything is headed. Number two, we know from what it says in Revelation, and frankly, we know from our experience, that there will be difficult times between now and the end. There is challenge, there is struggle, there is pain, and there is still death. We know these things. But here's my third conviction. I share it with you now. God is in control, and God is trustworthy, and whatever we suffer for Jesus will be worth it. Everything else really is just curiosity and telling the people around you to relax. God is in control. God is trustworthy. And whatever we suffer for Jesus will be worth it, because one day there's going to be this amazing Jerusalem. I mean, John describes it with, you know, being foundations built on all these jewels, some of which we don't even know exactly which gem is that anymore. But he's just, I mean, can you imagine trying to describe the city of God? He's trying here. That's where we're headed. And that's where we're going to go. I hope that you'll kind of keep studying with us as we unpack more and more of what God is saying to us. So there's going to be a lot that we go through. There are going to be some things that that maybe you'd like to hear about that you won't. That's why I very much appreciate the emails and calls that I get. Just, hey, Jesse, what about this? And what do you think about that? And can we talk? Let's talk about it. Because this is sometimes complex stuff to get into as we read it. And let us talk and reason together as we figure out what God is talking about and what exactly it is that he's trying to reveal to us through this book of Revelation. But I am thankful that we can do this all together. It's not just me sitting in a library somewhere reading stuff. It's not you just kind of getting together with a couple friends and saying, well, what do we do and what do we think? We get to be together, unpacking the scripture together. If I say something that sounds dumb or wrong, you can say, hey, wait, Jesse, hang on. And we can talk about that together and then correct it the next time. This is fun to be able to do this, and what a blessing. And what fun to be able to do it here today. Before we wrap up with our closing song, the band's going to come forward in just a minute. I'd like to pray again. Because I think there's all kinds of opportunity when we get into studying Revelation, thinking about the future, there's all kinds of opportunity for us to just get out of whack in our thinking, maybe get fascinated about things that ought not to fascinate us. So can we just pray and ask for God's wisdom and protection in our studies? Church, let's pray together. Lord, I thank you and praise you that you've given us your word. You've given us the Bible. I thank you that you spoke in this case to the prophet John, and that we get to read his writing as inspired by you. Lord, I thank you that we can think about it and pray about it together. And I pray, Lord, that you will help us to do this with all wisdom. Help us not to get carried away from things that should not get our attention, but help us to dive in deeply on the things that you are truly saying. Lord, help us be patient with each other, because some of us pick these things up more quickly. Lord, help us if we have preconceived ideas that are wrong, help those to be washed away. But Lord, if there is truth that you're speaking to us, help it to fall and lodge deeply in our hearts. Lord, we are thankful to get to do this together. We're thankful for all the blessings that you give us as we study and as we worship and as we pray. And Lord, we give all that we are now, even our minds, even our study, even our understanding, we give it all to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Church, would you stand as we sing our closing song this morning?
Stretched arm, I will bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And gave me your life. Thank you.
shame. You took my sickness and healed all my pain. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. With a grateful heart, with a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I will bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. Song of praise with an outstretched arm. I will bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you.
All right, so what do we do now? Well, here are a couple of things. I know the kids are coming back, so you can help them to find their spots. I know that we're working at this stuff in small groups. We had a number of you sign up to be in small groups last week. We're still getting some of that stuff together. But in our lobby, you'll notice that our decoration team was busy at work yesterday and some things are moved around. That's exciting for some and stressful for others. I know. We've only been here for a year and a half. Some of us are already locked into, well, that belongs there. Things move around from time to time. There is a sign-up sheet for small groups on the table by our mailboxes, okay? We have a prayer table inside, right by the doors to the sanctuary. If you have a prayer request that you'd like to write down, or if you're a guest with us today and you'd just like us to send you our newsletter and be connected, there's a connection card there right on the doors in the sanctuary in our lobby today. I'd like you to consider two opportunities to serve that are coming up. On Saturday, September 18th, we know the development back here on Wickersham Road, the tornado hit really hard there about 2 weeks ago. There are 9 or 10 homes that are condemned as they await repairs and all that kind of stuff. But there's a lot of cleanup work yet to do with some trees and stuff like that. On Saturday, the 18th, there's a group in town that's kind of organizing just a help day for that neighborhood. Details are still a little sketchy. I'll get those out as I know. But that might be something on Saturday if you have, especially if you have a saw, if you have a truck or a trailer that can help out. That's a great way for us to serve our neighbors. And then we've got two teams that are happening here at church. We've got a debt reduction team that's just working at our finances and dealing with our mortgage. And we've got a building design team that's talking about our upstairs room. If you'd like to be involved or think about either of those teams, talk to Jim Witter. He's number 11 back here, number one in your hearts. Today we're going to eat some lunch, okay? And the food's going to be around here to the south side. You'll see there's one table that's full of chili. We've got some very highly trained judges with very sensitive palates who are tasting it all, and they will give us an announcement in a little bit about which pot of chili is judged the best for 2021. But there is a bunch of pots of chili back there. We've got fresh French fries, thanks to King's Potatoes and Gerald King for putting that stuff together. Some hot dogs, there's some pulled pork, and then all the food that you guys brought. So I hope that you'll go back, get some food, eat it wherever you like. And here's my challenge to you, kind of the one last thing. See if you can spend some time talking to somebody you don't very well know at lunchtime today. It's pretty tempting to just come back to our families and huddle up here. It's a beautiful day and just think about, what are we going to do tonight? What are we going to do tomorrow? Where am I going to see you at the fair? But I would challenge you, make a new friend here today. Okay? If there's somebody that you see that you don't know, just go sit beside them. Introduce yourself. And maybe you've met them 20 times before. Okay. Learn today what their name is. Make a new friend and make somebody feel welcome. That's what you can do now. Sound good? When you go home, read Revelation and be blessed. So church, may you be blessed by the food that we're about to have. God, we thank you for the food that you've prepared. We thank you, Lord, for all the people who have pitched in to make this possible. We thank you, Lord, for the chance we've had to sing and think and pray together. We thank you, Lord, for the blessings of a beautiful spot to sit and a glorious weather condition to enjoy. Thank you, Lord. Now, Lord, as we go forward, I pray that you'll watch over us. Lord, help us to know your peace.
Help us to trust you and remember that you've got even the future in your control. And Lord, help us to be able to study without worry, because we know that you are the first and you are the last. You're the God who is and who was and who will always be. Lord, help us to remember these things. We need you and we love you. Amen. Church, it's good to see you. Go be the church.